park amounts to less than 1 million euros.
Live streaming is on.
With a unit cost of the work around 179 euros per square meter. SimuSoil allows us to quantify the values of 8 ESS, carbon sequestration, crop production, timber production, habitat quality, nutrient retention, sediment retention, crop pollination, and water yield. In particular, for each of them, a specific quantification, both in biophysical and ecological terms, is given by the software. However, for the main objective of this research, only biophysical benefits for the 8 ESS have been considered for the evaluation. In a second moment, the two scenarios are compared by considering the amount of ESS provided using SimuSoil. The two alternatives were designed in a zero-referenced CAD file, then imported in QGIS. Both the T0 and T1 scenario, the polygons have specific layers corresponding to the different land uses. In particular, the land uses changes must be associated with the Korean land cover classification, since SimuSoil calculates the biophysical values on a set of algorithms associated with land uses and provides output data in a raster map. As you can see, T0 is essentially characterized by a road network land cover with only a small green area, while in T1, the road network land cover is strongly reduced thanks to realization of recreational green areas, both on the overpass and in the north portion of the analyzed area. Moreover, additional trees are planted in all the project area. The output data provided by SimuSoil are reported in the table. It is important to underline only the ESS where values higher than zero are reported in the maps. The reason of the score is connected with the specific land use in the area. For example, the increase of CS, HQ, and TP in T1 can be explained by the great amount of new green spaces and vegetation considered in the regeneration project. Moreover, T1 strongly reduced the fragmentation of green areas compared to T0. The concentration of green spaces, in fact, provides better environmental performances, as well as more interaction between habitat sources and the creation of corridors and the reduction of threats. Moreover, since the economical results represent only indication, they are converted in final percentage, representing the increase of T0, T1 over T0, as shown in the last row of the table. According to the results of this research, not only the regeneration project is beneficial in terms of ESS provision, but also it is preferable from a merely financial perspective, since the overall cost of the overpass demolition activities are higher than the ones of the project proposed. Even if the monetary savings are limited, they are supported by biophysical and environmental benefit by 50%. The paper presents the application of an integrated framework for the strategic assessment of the CSIRM project that considers both financial and extra economic aspects. This analysis has underlined the advantages of combination cost-based and value-based approaches in order to highlight the benefits produced by the regeneration project of the Via Lucania overpass. On one hand, the application has shown how SimuSoil is a simple but effective tool. It aims to define the ability of a project to maximize benefits for both humans and environment through the ESS. This tool can be used by various professionals to rapidly assess in an ex-ante phase the ESS generated in land use scenarios and support the strategic environment assessment. The final output given by SimuSoil is very intuitive because it converts biophysical performances in an economical dimension. And at the end, the estimated costs of intervention and demolition can support a direct dialogue with the public administration together. However, some limits can be highlighted, in particular concerning the SimuSoil tool. Accordingly, future implementation of the present work will regard the adoption of more sophisticated tools in order to consider all the different benefits of T1 over T0. Moreover, the economical values obtained from SimuSoil can be connected with the estimated cost in an integrated approach like a cost-benefit analysis. Finally, it can be of particular interest to propose the combination of the results of the previous analysis with the NCDA performances in order to have an overall index, following, for example, the composite model for assessment approach proposed by. This proposal could be highly effective to propose the public bodies, and in particular the city of Milan, to support the project of the overpass in contrast to its demolition as an opportunity for the neighborhood to improve the community well-being, the environmental quality of the area, but also the potential economic externalities generated by the regeneration. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Roberta. I have no questions since I developed together with Caterina this research with you, so I know everything about it. I don't know if from the public or from
people. I have a question. I'd like to know. I read that in the
conclusion. Can you come here?
I have to come here.
Is on.
In the conclusion, I read that as a researcher of future perspective, you spoke about the consideration of intangible cultural values. And you mentioned also the application of the multi-criteria analysis as a means to deal with this dimension. I'd like to know if you have already done some application or already thought about how to consider and define the criteria for the consideration of these cultural values.
Thank you, Marco, for this question, because for time reason we don't spend much time about that, but it's very important to mention that, because Politecnico di Milano and Politecnico di Torino, in particular with the work of Roberta and then with the joint research with Marta Del Lovo, we have tried in different research to study the integration of biophysical and ecological values with sociocultural values, that in particular in this research is particularly relevant because it's related to a new recreational area for the city and for the people. So we have tried in different research to combine different approaches, and in our last research we have tried to use simply multi-criterial analysis in order to consider both tangible and intangible values. And in the same way, we have also tried, and we presented in another another seminar, an overall index that combine all these different values, ecological values and sociocultural values, by the use of the COSIMA approach. So if you are interested, I don't want to spend much time on that. If you are interested, we can share this research that are, of course, ongoing, and we have tried to, in some way, study this combination of different values.
Okay, thank you.
So thank you very much, because it's a little bit long to say all these things. Thank you.
Okay, I think there are no other questions. We can go on. Thank you again, Roberta. I know that now you have to go to work.
Yeah, thanks to you. Thanks for the presentation.
And also to Riccardo. I don't know if he's here, but anyway, thank you to both of you for this research.
Thank you.
Thank you. So going on always on the topic of the ecosystem services, the second contribution is going to be presented by Carlotta Pagliolo, and the title is Nature-Based Simulation to Address Climate Change-Related Flooding, Preliminary Insights on a Small-Sized Italian City, and it's been developed by Carlotta Pagliolo, Elena Comino, Alessandro Pezzoli from Politecnico di Torino. So I'm going to... I think that I'm going to move to give you.
Okay, so thank you for the presentation, Marta. I can start my presentation. I try to be fast. my paper and this work is structured in 5 macro sections. By including the problem framing and then the methodology section, the application results, and finally the conclusions. I can start saying that the extreme weather events are considered as the most significant global risk in the coming decade. And indeed, the cities are becoming increasingly vulnerable to extreme events, and especially by considering flash flooding, is a result of short duration intensive rainfall. And in the context of climate change, this scenario is exacerbated, mainly in coastal cities, where the compound flooding due to simultaneous runoff during the extreme rainfall is combined with the storm surge and sea level rise. And this is requiring a deepening in local knowledge of the flood prone areas. And in this context, where the climate change impacts are likely to require changes in urban planning adaptation, the nature-based solutions are considered as the new planning tool for ecologically sensitive urban development into the spatial planning, while addressing societal challenges like improving the human health and well-being in cities, but also by providing multiple benefits through the supply of urban ecosystem services. And having said that, this research aims to show the important role of ecosystem services implementation to support the climate change and adaptation planning. And considering that in urban planning, the ecosystem models can be used to develop flood management strategies, even if the limited experience with models and model output is a challenge for urban planners in thinking about addressing potential climate change impacts effectively, the new challenge is the need for spatially explicit biophysical assessment related to NBS scenarios implementation. And in this context, the specific goal of this research is to develop a spatial distribution estimate of urban flood-related risk, identifying the greatest critical areas by assessing biophysically where and how NBS can contribute to adapting the city to extreme rainfall events. For doing that, a spatial integrated evaluation method has been employed by combining the INVES modeling and the geographic information system tools. And considering that the INVES model, which means the integrated evaluation of ecosystem services and trade-off, which is part of the Natural Capital Project from the Stanford University, works with mainly with spatial models. The elaboration of the model inputs and model outputs has been developed through the help of GIS tools. And specifically, the model used for this analysis is the Urban Flood Risk Mitigation Model, which basically solves the empirical representation of the hydrological aspects for estimating the runoff production and the retention ability of the cities. Such integrated approach is also scenario-based, which means that the biophysical impact simulation has been developed through the identification of three scenarios. The first scenario is the base scenario, which means that which represents the present situation with a reference year of 2019, and in which the prioritization of the suitable areas for the implementation of NBS have been identified. And in that phase, the area for the NBS implementation have been provided. The first, the adaptation scenarios are the NBS one, which means is characterized by the implementation of green parking in all those areas that are classified as urban district with at least the 72% of impervious surfaces, and which resulted with a low retention capacity below the 60% from the base scenario. And the other future scenario is the NBS2, which provided the implementation of rain gardens along the roads, resulted with a low retention capacity around the 50 and 60% from the base scenario. The application of this research is the city of Rapallo, which is a coastal city in the metropolitan area of Genova, in the northern part of Italy. This city is covered by a big watershed that is related to the Boate Torrent and other several smaller basins. The climate is typical Mediterranean and is characterized by the rainier mainly the rainier season during winter season. But from recent studies, it has resulted that a lot of extreme rainfall events frequently occurred in different seasons, and causing also very intense flooding, especially in this part of the Liguria region that is called Levante. The data, the spatial data used, come from different sources that are at regional and also national level. The identification of NBS scenarios for the simulation has been developed under the Piano Nazionale di Adattamento al Cambiamento Climatico, and they are following also the Cloud Burst Action Plan of the Local Resilience Strategy, that is the Genova Lighthouse. And the changes in the simulation for the NBS scenarios are made on the curve number values for each of hydrological soil group. And this assumption keeps constant all the other data input. The results of this analysis and the biophysical impacts simulation are expressed through the runoff retention index, which represents the relative measure of the runoff volume retained per pixel. And this index ranges from zero, that means the that is a low retention capacity, to one, that means high retention. But also another the results are provided through the another index, which is the cumulative runoff retention volume, which is an absolute measure of the runoff. And overall, the average values of the retention capacity for all scenarios indicates a variation among 69 to 71% of the precipitation amount, which is retained in that catchment area of Rapallo. And specifically, the NBS1, which provided an implementation of green parking on the 10% of the urban district, is the most performing scenario, which represent higher retention mean value of retention capacity of 3%. So finally, I can conclude saying that this analysis is a first attempt to test and estimate the biophysical effects of NBS implementation on pluvial related flood mitigation on that catchment area. And specifically by using this urban flood risk mitigation model and also spatially elaborating the output through GIS environment, I can highlight how performance-based adaptation planning could aid to decision-making process. And particularly this INVEST model for estimating the urban flood risk is designed to suit hydrological aspects for an easy implementation in adaptation policy research. But also, this research is not lacking of some limits, and for future improvement, it could be deepened, for example, the threshold values changes related to the curve number for the hydrological soil groups for the different scenarios, and also for the identification and the definition of the measure and the NBS, it could be selected some different vegetation types for a high performance under different local conditions and also the changing climate conditions. And also this biophysical assessment could be improved by integrating a cost-benefit analysis of the NBS implementation, but with also considering the economic savings from flood damage reduction. So thank you for the attention.
Thank you, Carlotta, for your
interesting presentation, not on online or here, because otherwise I have actually a question for you, since also, as you know, we are working maybe on different levels, but on some topics that would be similar. So since you were talking at one of the conclusion, the limits of your research, do you think that, because this is something that I was thinking, that sometimes also the use of this software has a great number of limits given to the not so high flexibility on manipulating data. So do you think that also some of the limits could be related to the use of Invest, and how you can, let's say, overpass this kind of limits, so maybe combining other methodologies or other software?
Yes, I think really that this kind of software that are open source, and this is one of the main reasons that we are using a lot of this software, have a lot of limits, and also by using simple data input, and they also the function that are using the software, and the mathematical function and so on are very, very easy. But I think that it's very important to work with this software if we, and it depends and is related to what are you trying to analyze, and which is your goal of the research. So if you are using this kind of software for doing a part of your research and your analysis, and then you can integrate with other modeling or methodologies or other kind of this stuff, it's good to work with this software. So it's good to integrate with different kind of methodologies, I think so. And it's very important because, especially if we are, if we want to work with the decision-making process and the policies, and we want to support the policies, and it's very important because we cannot use very specific and modeling that are not understandable mm-hmm. from different kind of, yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I think so.
Okay. I completely agree with the integration of different methodologies, and also how to communicate the results is depending also about with who you are talking,
yeah, exactly.
And also the use of these maps are going to help also the visualization of the results. So could be a support, but maybe they cannot work alone, but they should be integrated also by other, let's say, analysis methodologies.
Yeah. And I think also that this kind of limit can be overcome by working with different scenarios. Mm-hmm. So you don't have one scenario, one situation, condition, this is only the one, and this is the kind of present situation and so on. No, we can work with different scenarios. And we can work with different range of values. So we can say from this value to this, mm-hmm. we have this situation.
Okay.
And yeah, I think that it could be one of
the solutions.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
So thank you.
Thank you. So we can pass to the next contribution presented by Vanessa Suma, titled "The Model of Analysis and Assessment to Support the Valorization and Management of Green Areas in the Royal Gardens of Turin, Italy," that has been developed by Vanessa Summa, Daniele Duetto, Gabriele Carnero, and Giulio Mondini. So, please, Vanessa, the floor is yours.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Thanks very much for the presentation. As already said, this is a joint research with the architect Daniele Duetto, that is the object of his research thesis, in collaboration with the professor Gabriele Carnero and Giulio Mondini. In particular, this research work founds the Royal Museums of Turin. In fact, the object of the thesis is focused on the building of a model of analysis and assessment to valorize and manage, in particular, the green historic heritage, with particular focus on the Royal Gardens of the city of Turin in northern Italy. In particular, the model of analysis and assessment found itself on the geographic information systems and on development of an extended version of the SWOT analysis in order to provide a model of decision-making utility for planners, decision makers, and other specialized bodies in order to provide specific strategies and actions to care of the green historic heritage. This is the structure that I'm going to follow for this presentation. In particular, moving to the definition of the context, as you know, green areas, in particular the green historic heritage, contribute to generate a lot of benefits for the health of urban and territorial systems. In particular, by providing the production of ecosystem services, the green historic heritage represents a connective tissue between the urban and architectural context, and also can provide the social and the cultural values to both present and next generations. But it is also very important to stress this period of high uncertainty, not only carried by the pandemic, but also by the ongoing climate change and the human impacts. In fact, several green areas of the green historic heritage is compromised by several disasters, such as the eradication of the historic trees or the diffusion of endogenous pathogens, thus compromising its value. And in this sense, it is highly needed the monitoring, the enhancement and management of the green heritage and its social, economic and environmental value. In this context, in particular in the context of an apprenticeship in collaboration of the student with the Royal Museum of Turin, it has been developed a model of analysis and assessment that is composed by the GIS tools and an extended version of the SWOT analysis that can be integrated within the analysis and evaluation process, in particular following the ex-ante, in-itinere, and the ex-post phases, where real actors and stakeholders have been involved. Spending some notes about the methodology. As you know, the geographic information systems are highly recognized by the literature for their ability to collect and elaborate data and provide more complex information. In this sense, obtaining analysis and a logical representation to interpret the real-world dynamics. And in particular, this application adopts the update of the Italian Ministerial Decree number 63 of the 2020 that update the normative on the minimum environmental criteria for the public green management service and the supply of the green care products. In particular, a GIS-based topographical database has been developed in following the minimum environmental criteria, thus collecting the data and associating them at a univocal code, but we will see this aspect in the subsequent slides. About the SWOT analysis, SWOT analysis is the most common used tool, especially in the context of the urban territorial planning, in order to analyze the given decision problem by characterizing the endogenous and exogenous factors. SWOT analysis has been extended over time, also by integrating itself with other interesting models, such as the STIP analysis plus the SWOT analysis or the AWOT, among others. But in this case, we propose a novel extension, in particular a SWOT analysis that can provide an analysis of the state of the art of the context under investigation and the evaluation of the same context to work by considering a trend scenario. In particular, we have considered a selection of macro-ambits and sub-ambits that better represent the context under investigation at the Royal Gardens of Turin. We have developed a SWOT analysis according to a participatory modality by involving real actors and stakeholders, and we have also assessed the contacts collected through a quali-quantitative evaluation in order to measure the degree of incidence of each element. And finally, we have obtained a partial and total scores in order to provide an immediate view of the final results. This is the case study that we have chosen. This is the Royal Gardens of Turin. They belong to the Royal Palace that is one of the outstanding residences of the Savoy dynasty and that have been inscribed within the World Heritage List of UNESCO in 1997. This Royal Gardens has been chosen for a particular motivation. This is not only a green area, so this is a green historic area that cannot be crystallized over time, so that it requires constantly valorization and management to be transmitted to the next generations. In particular, in the context of the apprenticeship, the application has been focused only to a part of this case study because a part of it was under restoration. So the case study focuses in particular on the Duke's Garden, the Green Bastion, the Garden of Arts, and the Boschetto. About the results obtained with the GIS method, here you can see some meaningful steps in order to develop this GIS topographical database. So starting from the definition of the geometry type of the elements as points, lines, and surface, the identification of the main type of each element following specific categories such as the vegetation, the street furniture, the use and management, and environmental factors. Then the identification of the secondary type of the elements to differentiate, for example, the alone from a flower bed or a plant. And finally, the attribute assignment. In particular, considering a specific example, assuming a code like a plant as a further classification, it allows to distinguish, for example, a tree from a bush. Moving to the results obtained with the SWOT analysis, here you can see the SWOT analysis that has been developed by considering an inertial scenario, so focusing on the state of the art that corresponded to the summer time of the 2019 in our case. And you can see in the upper side of the slide some meaningful example to understand how this SWOT analysis has been filled. For example, a score of 3 was assigned to the sub-ambit international tourism by a specific stakeholder, that in our case is the Royal Museum and the City of Turin, since they provided the data on the number of visitors varied by quantity and period. And it shows that most of the entrances to the palace is represented by foreign tourists. Or even a score of 2 was assigned to a significant green spot sub-ambit by the City of Turin, since the Royal Gardens represent a green center in the city. Or even a negative score of -3 was assigned to the presence of fine dust deposited on the foliage by, in this case, by the citizens, as it impacts on the physical health, especially in a polluted city like Turin that records medium-low level of air quality, especially in the winter season. This is SWOT metrics that consider the variation between the state of the art and the trend scenario that represents in particular the COVID-19 pandemic. So in this case, you can see some useful examples of how to fill these metrics. So -2 points was assigned to the foreign tourism, meaning that a decrease in the assignment by the Royal Museum staff with respect to the previous score assigned in the SWOT analysis. The COVID-19 pandemic has significantly reduced the foreign tourism flux. And when the full-colored symbol is present, this means that no variation has been occurred. This value was already presented at the time zero. When the same symbol is surrounded by a black border, it means that a new assignment has been provided in the SWOT analysis. as outcome, the GIS tools and the SWOT analysis can be used and applied as separately, but they can also be integrated to provide a specific outcome, to provide a set of strategies to be delivered to decision makers, planners, and other specialized bodies that in our case can be synthesized in the preservation, valorization, and management of the green historical heritage, and each strategy can provide a set of actions. In this case, this is an ongoing research, so this is a step that we will develop in the future. And in this context, we have provided some examples that can be correlated to the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals or to projects that can be presented within the National Plan of Recovery and Resilience. So we have also identified pros and cons about this application. In particular, this model can be considered a reliable support for the decision-making process for the monitoring and assessment of the green historical heritage. The GIS database, structured according to the minimum environmental criteria, received a very positive feedback by the Royal Museum staff, in particular on the managerial and organizational features. The SWOT analysis allowed a simultaneous reading between the different macro ambits and sub ambits. But we have also detected some limits. In particular, the development of the GIS plus SWOT analysis requires specific skills that sometimes revealing difficult to be interpreted by the public bodies. And the COVID-19 pandemic limited the communication with the engaged local actors and stakeholders. In this sense, we have identified some future research directions. The MAC classification will be, of course, implemented, and a set of alternative scenarios will be designed and assessed through the SWOT analysis time zero, time one. The GIS plus SWOT analysis can support economic evaluation methods like the hedonic prices in order to provide the estimation of the total economic value of this cultural asset. It will also develop a novel extension through open programming language in order to provide a software to be used easily by public bodies. So thanks so much for the kind attention.
Thank you, Vanessa, for your interesting and innovative contribution. So, are there any questions?
Online, some questions?
Okay. So, I have a question that is mostly a curiosity. Do you think that this method can be used also for the monitoring of the development of the strategies that you think of for the development of the garden? So do you think that this SWOT can be adapted to monitor the development of the strategies and the results?
Yes, of course. In fact, this is an ongoing research, in fact, and we have also considered several paths to analyzed and investigated. In particular, at this moment, we will implement the SWOT analysis by considering not only the inertial and the trend scenario, but also moving toward alternative strategic scenarios, so helping public bodies in particular to design the strategies in order to respond and to be more resilient with respect to the high uncertainty of this period that can deal with the green management, but also for the job opportunities or the progressive digitalization of the public administration. So we retain that this model can support in this sense in the helping the public bodies in the digitalization or the bureaucratical aspects that can limit in some manner some the activation of some actions, specific interventions that often cannot mirror the real time scale of the that is characterized by this uncertainty.
So it is a dynamic evaluation method.
Exactly, it is also characterized by a certain adaptability.
Okay.
So this is an advantage, and we will see, I hope, in subsequent contributions.
Thank you.
So thanks very much.
Thank you. So, okay, so we can pass to the last contribution of this first part of our section. The contribution is presented by Federico Dell'Anna, and it is titled The Regeneration of a Shopping Center Starts from Consumers' Preferences and Best Worst Scaling Applications, that has been developed by Mauro Berta, Marta Bottero, Marina Bravi, Federico Dell'Anna, and Andrea Rappari. So, Federico, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Giulia. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So, good morning, everybody, and welcome to this session. The research that I will share with you now is developed in collaboration with my colleagues from Politecnico di Torino. And in this research, the economic discipline meets the urban design. In particular, these studies want to investigate the use of economic approach in order to support the regeneration design of existing shopping center, thanks to a best worst scaling experiment. The presentation is structured in as follows. After a brief presentation of the object of the aim of the research, I will show the method that we have applied. I will show you an application to a real case studies, and finally I will summarize the main conclusion and future perspectives. We found that the spread of shopping centers began in the USA in the 60s and 70s, occupying the suburbs of cities, facilitated by the phenomenon of urban sprawl. But for several decades, determined the creation of new center of aggregation outside the city in the immense American steppes. But in the 90s, this real estate asset experienced an unexpected crisis phenomenon that determined the closure of more of these big boxes. Obviously, these effects it is not limited to the boundaries of these box, but these effects were extended to the surrounding areas and on the society living around them. This phenomenon affected also European and European countries, but with limited impacts. The main reason of this closure of this dead mall are the competition between the structure, the non-maintenance of the system, and the failure of the shop that generally are located in the gallery of this building. Over the years around the world, different projects, design solutions have been proposed for the revitalization of this building that can be clustered in four main actions. From the integration of new functions to the internal and external restyling, to the reuse and to the complete dismantling and replacement of the building. So in this field, it becoming important to understand the consumer's preferences in order to identify the most appropriate intervention to give the building a new lease of life. So the method that we have chosen in order to investigate the user preferences, the consumer preferences, is the best worth scaling. This method was proposed by Finn Olivier in 1992 and belongs to the family of discrete choice model. As the most traditional approach, like conjoint analysis, discrete choice experiment, this method provide a set of choice sets in a surveys that combine different items. Compared to the other approach, the best worth scaling methods ask the respondents to indicate only two choices. To indicate, in other words, the items that give the highest positive utility for the best and the highest negative utility for the worst items. Compared to the other approach, the best worth scaling have some advantage from the most important. It requires a lower cognitive effort for respondents, and it is more effective when the sample is small. On the other hand, some disadvantage. It is necessary to take into account because, for example, the best worth scaling doesn't allow to show the status quo. So it is necessary to choose almost an items, to indicate an items, and it does not make possible to give the same importance to two or more items. As I said before, we have tested these methods to a real case studies. In particular, we have chosen a shopping center located in Turin, in Italy, which in recent years has suffered from competition from a new shopping center located near the new Area 12, built very close to the Juventus Stadium. The structure of the shopping center is typical of the building of the shopping center of the 80s, and it is characterized by the single building with an internal gallery and two anchor stores and small shops distributed along a covered gallery. To try to identify the design guideline for the regeneration of this shopping center, we set a survey. In particular, we have built a questionnaire that is structured in these four parts. First, a short introduction describes the aim of the research. A second section captured the consumer habits. The third section included the choice experiment based on best worth scaling. And the last part collected some socioeconomic information for the of the respondents in order to validate the survey results. With regard to the items that we included, we have proposed 24 attributes that can be clustered in different subteams, such as the offers, the interior and exterior design, the installation new function, and the parking typology. As mentioned above, therefore, the experiment involved the set of six questions per respondents, five items were presented for each choice set. The respondent that had to select the best and the worst items for each choice set. We have collected firstly 600 questionnaire, but after a verification phase, only 4073 questionnaire have been considered valid to develop the survey. Also, you can see the respondents come informally from all over Italy, and most of them are family members, which give us a good representation of shopping center users. So about the results of the best worst scaling experiment, interesting results can be drawn. In particular, in the first position of the ranking of the different items, so we found that the configuration of open space for sale, for recreational activity, and for the distribution in the shopping center. On the other hand, service spaces and traditional recreational activity like the cinema multiplex provide a little utility to consumers. These results may have been influenced by the condition during the pandemic period and due to the restriction imposed by the Italian government. In fact, the survey was developed between the September and the October 2020. Therefore, it would be interesting to understand if the needs alleged by the survey are still valid today, or if they are influenced by the condition generated by COVID-19. So the results deriving from the questionnaire, the configuration of the commercial center and the investigation, more in line with the preference and the utilities provided to the users of the today's users. So the results obtained were also in line with the various case studies that have been investigated before the implementation of the survey. In detail, the projects prefer open space, both inside and outside the buildings, and specialized commercial offers. New green space, public square, and open space for events. In conclusion, it can be said that the best worst scaling methods succeeded in investigating new consumer needs in the area of mass sales. However, the results may have been influenced by the particular condition we were in when the survey was developed. So, therefore, as future perspective, we plan to develop the same survey in the future in order to check the validity of the results obtained. In addition, further questionnaire would allow us to segment the sample and investigate different subgroups of consumers. Thank you.
Oh, okay. Sorry, the microphone was off. So okay. Thank you so much, Federico, for your interesting contribution. And here in the room, there are no questions, but I have a curiosity for you. So have you developed the robustness analysis of the result that you obtained?
Okay, thank you for your question. We developed a sort of sensitivity analysis, but I didn't have time and I skipped the slide to to be present. So basically we clustered the sample in different subsegments in order to have homogeneous group and compare the ranking of the different group. Alpha is the sample is not so large. The results confirmed that the best solution are constant, while the worst solution change their position. In particular, the multiplex cinema solution is always the worst. In the future, as I said before in the conclusion, it's for us it is most important it will be important to verify with a larger sample if the results remain constant for all the age groups that we have investigated.
Thank you for your clarification. So before to conclude this first part of our section, I would like to thank you to all of the participants and to all of the speakers. So thank you all, and we will see in the second part of our section. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the second part of the workshop MES 2021. I take the occasion to thank all to be here today, to be connected to the session. So I want to introduce the first contribution that is entitled How to Manage Conflicting Values in Minor Highlands, INCDA Methodology Toward Alternative Energy Solution Assessments by Marco Rossitti and Francesca Torrieri. I leave the floor to Marco Rossitti.
Thank you, Vanessa, for your presentation. Good morning, everybody. I'm Marco Rossitti. I'm a PhD candidate from Politecnico di Milano. I'm a PhD candidate from Politecnico di Milano, and today I will present you one of my research lines that I'm developing with Professor Francesca Torrieri from Federico II in Naples. And this research is about how to manage conflicting values in minor island, MCDA methodology towards alternative energy solution assessment. Here is the outline of my presentation that moves from an introduction devoted to understanding the challenges of energy transition. Then it goes through the description of the case study represented by Pantelleria Island that would be used for the application of methodological framework towards alternative energy solution assessment. Then I will describe the application of this methodological framework to a project for Pantelleria Island. And finally, I'll draw out some results and conclusions. So, since the late 1970s, the increasing attention to environmental issues has led to experimenting with sustainable solutions on energy and water in a circular economy perspective. As a consequence, transition to sustainable energy sources is placed at the core of the national and international agenda, but it cannot be addressed merely in technical terms. Indeed, as suggested by Simons, energy transition is more than merely a technical infrastructural issue. Indeed, we can identify at least other three dimensions that are the economic, the political, and the emotional. In this context, the research provides an analytic framework to support decision makers in managing energy transition complexity and defining the favorable energy supply solution for minor islands. Indeed, the great concern towards energy transition has resulted in a strong legislative process, both at the European level and at the Italian level. At the European level, we have several directives and communication that since 2009 focus on the topic of energy transition, coming to the last one that is well known as the European Green Deal. At the Italian level, among the different legislative measures devoted to dealing with energy transition, we have some very interesting legislative measures that focus on energy transition in minor islands. In particular, there are two ministry decree from 2017 that deal with this topic. Indeed, both these decree recognize minor island potential in addressing energy transition, and the former decree defines a list of minor island for its application. Thus, resulted our interest in focusing on this topic of energy transition in minor island, and we choose Pantelleria Island as case study. But why Pantelleria? Because Pantelleria Island owns a strong potential in terms of renewable sources, as sun, wind, and geothermal energy. Then the island has no independence in terms of energy supply, and it's very important to transition to sustainable energy sources. Then Pantelleria administration is targeting to pursue the sustainable energy transition, and finally the cultural and aesthetical significance of its landscape require proper decision support tools able to manage complexity. As concern Pantelleria municipality struggle towards energy transition, we have to say that Pantelleria municipality in 2013 joined the European Covenant of Measures for Climate Energy, and in 2020 it approved the Clean Energy Transition Agenda for Pantelleria that aims at decarbonization and energy independence through high penetration of renewable energy sources and technological innovation. In particular, the sector of interventions are identified in the photovoltaic, the wind plants, geothermal energy, and wave motion. So we try to define some decision support tool to support energy transition, in particular a MCDA methodology to evaluate different energy solutions. So, the definition of methodology towards alternative energy solution assessment, able to consider and manage conflicting values and complexity, calls for a robust scientific framework. This framework can be identified in Simon decision-making model applied to alternative energy solution assessment. This model is made up by three phases: an intelligent phase devoted to the decisional context definition, a design phase devoted to the decision modeling, and at the end, a choice phase devoted to decision making. Now I will describe the application of these different phases to our case study represented by a project for Pantelleria Island. So, first of all, we set the objective of our study that again is supporting decision makers in deciding among alternative scenarios for the transition to green and circular energy supply models. Then we moved to the modeling and criteria definition phase. Indeed, we selected the reference methodological approach for the evaluation of alternatives and we identified it in the multi-criteria decision analysis. Thus, we defined the criteria for the assessment and the related indicators for measuring the alternatives performance, and we also defined the energy supply alternatives to be evaluated. So we defined three alternatives stemming both from Pantelleria potentialities and from the suggestions included in the Clean Energy Transition Agenda for Pantelleria Island. So we have three scenarios: a solar-based scenario based on installing photovoltaic modules on shelters and on the ground in proximity to the retaining walls that are a typical feature of Pantelleria landscape. Then a wind-based scenario resting on the installation of three wind microturbines, and a traditional scenario based on the current system of electricity production through an oil-fired power plant. So, the three scenarios were evaluated according to a set of criteria, and in order to consider the complexity of such a decisional issue, we divided these criteria in two groups, technical economical criteria and cultural environmental. So, for each criteria, we defined several sub-criteria. For example, as concerned technical economic criteria, we had the construction cost, the management and maintenance cost, construction time, and so on. While for the cultural environmental, we have the sustainability in facing climate change, noise impact, ecosystem impact, visual impact. For each of them, we defined the unit of measurement, we described the way in which it was possible to calculate these sub-criteria, and then we defined the performance for the three alternatives. Here is the graphic representation of the performances of each alternative according to the different criteria. That can be very useful to make some specific consideration about the performance of the alternatives. Then, as concerned the MCDA implementation, we combine the LECTRE method with the SRF method for the criteria weighting. More in detail, the weighting process was based on the interaction with two stakeholders from the municipality of Pantelleria, representative of the technical office and the political office. By analyzing the results according to the political stakeholder preferences expressed in terms of weight and the technical stakeholders, we can see that in both cases, the solar-based scenario stands out as the favorable one, and so it can be used as reference for energy transition projects in Pantelleria Island. So we can say that, as shown by our case study, the proposed methodological framework can represent a useful and practical tool for supporting policies towards the green energy transition. Its novelty lies in considering the conflicting values stemming from energy transition applied to complex territorial contexts. Another strength point can be found in its replicability to similar contexts at the national and international level by carefully adapting it in light of a place-based approach. Finally, we have to say that this methodology still shows some room for improvement when dealing with the cultural and environmental dimensions. Firstly, the MCDA results can be integrated with the ones from a life cycle assessment in order to better focus on the environmental impacts from the different technological solutions. More effort can be also devoted to include the impacts from the different energy alternatives on landscape in aesthetical terms and potential effect on its tangible and intangible values. Finally, it's also worth deepening the social impacts of green energy supply solution on local communities. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you very much, Marco, for the presentation. Also, no online, only for us. Okay, thank you, Marco, because the topic is very, of course, interesting. Also, in relation to the possible implementation of wind recovery fund and so on. So, thank you very much. I have more a curiosity than a question. The case study that you have used is a quite specific area. So I think that, of course, the data are strictly related to this area. So my question is related to this aspect and how the model that you have implemented, the indicators that you have chosen are so site specific or can be used in other contexts simply or with some additional implementation.
Okay, thank you for this question, because I think that this is a very important topic when we deal with the decision support tool applied to peculiar context as Pantelleria is. So, of course, it is necessary to adapt the criteria, so the decision tree, we can say, to the context under study. For example, I have to say that among the selected criteria, I had the ecosystem impact that it was declined to Pantelleria specificities because most of Pantelleria Island is protected as a special protected area for the flight birds. And by considering alternative energy scenario, for example, the wind turbines, it was necessary to deal with this aspect. That in another context that is not subjective to these rules, probably not necessary. And also, for example, the visual impact that for Pantelleria landscape, that is a terraced landscape with very peculiar characteristics, is a prominent aspect. To other, in another context, could be also amended. So, of course, some criteria should be kept, for example, the construction cost and others of this kind that are more also objective and quantitative, but others should be adapted to the context under study.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much also for other contribution in this sense. It is useful to underline this aspect. I completely agree with your what you said.
Our streaming is on.
Okay. So probably Federico Dellana has some problem because have other another seminar. So I pass to the last contribution, the one entitled New Cohesion Policy 2021-2027, the role of indicators in the assessment of SDGs target performance, that is presented by Vanessa Summa and Giulia Datola, and with the collaboration of Professor Mondini from Politecnico di Torino. So Vanessa and Giulia, the floor is yours. Seminar by Urban Promo, so many authors are also involved in that conference, and so we have moved some contribution in order to give the possibility to all the other authors to participate in both the seminar. Okay, we have the presentation.
Okay, so now.
So thank you, Caterina. Thank you, Caterina, for the introduction and for the time. So today, me and my colleague Vanessa Sim will present this contribution that we developed with the collaboration and the supervisor of Professor Giulio Mondini. This. Sorry.
Full screen.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so this contribution aims at highlight and represent the usefulness of indicators and indices in the assessment of the performance of cities and territory with a specific reference to the sustainability development goals and their targets. In the context of the European Cohesion Policy 2021-2027. For this proposal, we developed an impact matrix in order to measure the performance of each indicator we selected in the achievement of these sustainable development goals and their targets. Moreover, we apply this methodology to a real case study, the city of Ridley in Piedmont. As we can see by the next slide, the proposed model on the one hand can be useful to support the decision-making process in the assessment and also in the monitoring procedure, but also on the other hand, it can be also interest of technicians and freelancers in order to simplify and optimize the conventional planning procedures in order to present the project proposal of territorial transformation and also with the aim to represent and present strategies with medium and long time perspective. So the presentation is structured into these six sections. As we know, cities and also territorial systems are actually affected by several pressures that belongs to the climate change, the land take, the disaster emergency, the social conflict, the linear economy, and also of the human actions. These pressures create some impacts that affect this territorial system, and these impacts are the affect the environmental components, the ecosystem services, the healthy soil, and also the healthy and the well-being of the citizen. So the challenge within these scenarios is integrating and also combining the paradigm of the sustainability and the resilience in the planning process, also with the aim of integrating the SDGs and also their target, following also the new cohesion policy 2021 and 2027. So for this application, as I already said, we propose an impact matrix in order to assess the impact of the system, the sustainable development goals and their targets on the hazard, the vulnerability and exposure of territorial system and cities. In detail, the hazard concerns the potential occurrence of a natural or man-made event. The vulnerability concerns the vulnerability of the urban system or rather its predisposition to be adversely affected, and the exposure stands for the level of the exposure to the risk of infrastructural assets of the urban system. So to perform and develop this impact matrix, we specifically identify a multidimensional set of indicators related to this aspect. Here we have the list of indicators specifically identified for our case study. For example, related to the hazard, we identify the annual precipitation variation. For the vulnerability, for example, we identify the age of buildings and also the production of activities and also the inactive population. So we can see that these indicators are multidimensional and represent the society dimension and also the infrastructural. For example, for the exposure, we consider the environmental components, the cultural heritage that records the number of protected cultural assets in the considered territory. So we can see that our indicators aims at integrating and also consider different aspects that are related to the 17 goals and the target in our evaluation.
So the case study that we have chosen for the application of the impact matrix is the city of Rivoli that is located in Piedmont region in Italy. The choice motivation is closely related to the fact that this municipality has been interested by an increase of on inhabitants, especially during the pandemic. In fact, this municipality is so natural conglomerate of the metropolitan city of Turin. So we have retained that is a very interesting case study to be investigated according to the sustainability and resiliency principles. So we can move on the next slide where you can see the feeling of the matrix. We have developed the impact matrix by considering all the SDGs, but we have not so much time to provide the entire impact matrix. So we have focused on the 11th SDG on sustainable cities and communities and its related targets. So as you can see, the impact matrix has in rows the SDG and its related targets, such as the cultural and natural heritage, or the green and public spaces, or even the rural and urban linkages. And these have been assessed, in particular their impacts on the components of hazards, vulnerability and exposure, and their related indicators that we have previously represented. And so each cell of the impact matrix has been assessed by considering the degree of impacts of each SDG on the specific indicators. In particular, this impact can be conceived as a positive or also a negative impact. So the impact cannot be considered only negative, but we can have also positive impacts or of direct or indirect nature. And we have represented, in order to provide an immediate view of the results, with the positive and negative symbols. So we can move on the next slides. We can comment some of the results that we have obtained for the SDG 11. In particular, we would focus on the 11.4 on the cultural and natural heritage that is has a positive impacts, both direct or indirect, on most of the indicators that we have considered. So by achieving this target, we can have most benefits on the urban territorial transformation of the city of Rivoli. But we have also a very important achievements on the 11.B, and so the comprehensive disaster risk management that can contribute to better and a more safe transformation of the future of the of this city. But we can also consider the column, so we can read in a double view this impact matrix, and so the indicator HE.4 has a positive relationship with most of the targets that we have considered. In this case, this is the age of buildings. So if we will consider, for example, the disaster risk management, we can consider most of the buildings that that exist in this city, and so contributing for a more safe for a more safe future. So we can move on the conclusion. This application has identified positive aspects but also some limits. In particular, we can assert that this impact matrix can assess the performance of the city of Rivoli in achieving the SDGs and their targets, thanks to the integration between the indicators and the impact matrix. The indicators allow it to focus on specific features, in particular related to the climate risk factors, and understand complex dynamics. The impact matrix can identify different typology of impacts, as I have already said, and the structure of this matrix is flexible, and the considered indicators can be chosen and performed according to the city characteristics. So we can have, in some manner, replicability of this impact matrix in other different cities and of a different size. The impact chain can support the design and the schedule of actions and programs realization. About the limits that we have detected, the feeling of the matrix require a good base of knowledge of the case study. So we must analyze the territorial characteristics of the city to better interpret its complex dynamics. And in particular, the desktop modality, and so the feeling of the matrix by a panel of experts, is not the proper one to support the planning programming. So as a future perspective, we retain to apply these impact matrix by considering the real actors and stakeholders. So as a future research directions, the impact matrix will integrate the MCDA to assess the prioritization of the SDGs and their targets according to alternative planning scenarios for this city. A panel of actors and stakeholders will be engaged in order to identify and implement the sets of indicators, and we will consider, of course, the participatory modality in the filling of this matrix. So thanks very much for the kind attention.
Okay, thank you, Giulia and Vanessa, for the presentation. You give us a very interesting perspective and, in my opinion, quite simple tool, I think, that, for example, public administration could use in order to understand the way in which they work on SDGs and how to try to implement their strategies in cities, in municipalities, also in very different contexts, as you say, not only in Rivoli, but also in other bigger cities. So I have a curiosity related to this aspect. Do you think that the public administration are able, in your opinion, to fill this matrix, or they need in some way an help from the university, or need some tools in order to have the answer to fill the entire matrix? Is a curiosity, because you don't have much time to spend.
Okay. I can try to answer to this, to satisfy your curiosity. Of course, this is a flexible and also simple tool. We need to support the public administration with more user-friendly techniques, softwares, because not at all the public administration has specific skills to deal with the increasing complexity of the cities and the territories. And especially, we can apply this impact match with a specific focus on the risk management, on the ex-ante disaster, but we can also apply it on the post-disaster when we have not so much time to make some assessment and analysis. Of course, the public administration retains a good knowledge of the territory in question, under investigation, And from this aspect, I can assert that there is no a limit in the mm-hmm. in the application. Of course, the filling of the matrix and so the attribution, the degree of impact, I think it closely depends on the sensibility of the individual actor stakeholder with respect to the phenomenon under investigation. So I think this is very promising, and I think that it needs a replication in order to test the sensitivity in the application of these impact metrics.
Okay.
So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for your work. So now, very, very fast, we get to the last contribution of this session.
Yes.
Okay. So the contribution is entitled Geographically Weighted Regression Models to Investigate Urban Infrastructure Impacts. It was presented by Federico Dell'Anna online, and with the collaboration, this research, with the collaboration of Professor Bottero and Professor Bravi from Politecnico di Torino. So Federico, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. I try to share the screen. Can you see my screen in
yes,
full screen way?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, good. So in this second presentation, I will share you with you a research that I am carrying out in collaboration with Professor Marta Bottero and Professor Bravi. And in detail, the research aimed to give a support to planners and decision makers in the definition of design choice and policy in the field of urban transformation, thanks to the help of spatial econometrics model. The presentation will follow this structure. After the introduction of the topic, I will present the objective of the research, the method used, the application of the models proposed to a real case studies, and the results. Finally, I will conclude with the conclusions and future perspective. We know that the city is a complex system. The transformation of the territory that arises from the demand for service, connection, and free time area imply the use of monetary resources. But such investment and disinvestment can induce, produce both positive and negative externalities. Often the results of these transformation are not all obvious and require a cost-benefit balance. In this perspective, the quantification of these effects appears to be an increasingly important operation to guide the process with a view of social equity. The need to estimate and to investigate the measure of the effects of a transformation and of change in terms of urban quality seems to have grown more and more over the years in the sector of the economic evaluation. Estimation methods have been applied over the year, which make it possible to quantify the impacts in mainly in monetary value in order to be included also in evaluation required, for example, like the cost benefit analysis required by the European Commission. On the other hand, a branch of the research focused attention in the definition of the visualization or tool in order to show the results in easy way. and make possible that all users can be able to understand the meaning of these of the results. One of the methods that have been used for the investigation of the impacts of the infrastructure is the Donick Price method. The basic hypothesis lies that in the assumption that the value of a property is linked to the utility attributed to the structural and external characteristics of a property. Starting from this assumption, it's possible to break down the total price of the property into the different marginal price of the characteristic that determine the overall value of the property. In recent years, the Donick Price method has been used in the studies of the phenomena distributed in space, thanks to the integration with the geographical information system that which allow to specialize both the input data and the results, and to study the interaction between the building in the infrastructure in the space. In particular, the spatial econometrics has mainly studies the two phenomena that can occur in the real estate market, the spatial dependence and the spatial heterogeneity. Given the research question that we set, we focused on the family of geographically weighted regression model. That is a method that studies the relationship between the independent and dependent variables throughout in the space. So, in other words, these methods allow to investigate how the relationship vary in the space. In few words, the geographically weighted regression is based on a set of local linear model, which is calibrated considering the data of nearby observation. In order to calibrate the model, calculate the weight matrix, the geographical weighted regression use a single bandwidth to identify the nearby observation. The limit of this approach is that it considers a single bandwidth for all covariates, assuming that all variables vary in the same way, in the same geographical scale in the space. In order to overcome this limit, Fotheringham and colleagues proposed a local regression model that allows the covariates to vary in the space in different ways. So doesn't use a specific bandwidth, but using multiple bandwidths, one for each studied phenomenon. In these studies, we experimented the efficiency of both models in order to understand which works better in the real estate domain. The case studies, in order to test these two models, is the real estate market of Singapore, that is located in the southeast of Asia. In these studies, we considered the market segment of the multi-family houses. So we have collected about 3,500 transactions of dwelling of apartments sold between 2015 and 2017. About the variable considered in the model, we used the structural characteristics such as surface, floor, time variable in terms of age of the building, and accessibility variable like transportation infrastructure. In this case, we considered the metro line, the bus stop, the distance from the highway, and the distance from the recreational area like natural park or regional park. In detail, in order to consider the accessibility variable, we calculate the Euclidean distance from the nearest infrastructure from each apartment included in the dataset. The first step of the studies required to develop a traditional regression model based on ordinary least squares estimator. This model allows us to understand if the variables are significant, that there are no correlation among the variables, and to verify that the sign of the coefficient makes sense. After we have applied the two local regression models, the geographical weight regression, the multi-scale. In this slide, you can to develop these studies, we use the software proposed by Fotheringham. That is a very user-friendly software. And in this study, we have summarized the main results of the this local regression model. Or you can see we used an adaptive B-square function in order to define the bandwidth that that calculates the best number of neighbors to give to calculate the difference of among the different observations. So the first conclusion that we can arise from this model is that it works better compared to the traditional one, compared to the ordinary square, because the R squared indicator is higher compared to the previous model. Subsequently, we have implemented also the multi-scale geographic weighted regression model, and you can see the software calculated the different bandwidths for each coordinate. These results give us expected results, because the model calculating multiple bandwidths allow to consider the variation of the different covariates for in the space. In particular, for the structural variable, the software calculated a short distance, for example, floor area and level floor, with a bandwidth that range from 44 to 334 neighborhoods to consider, while for the accessibility variable, the analysis was carried out in a global way. Thanks to GIS tool, was able also to represent in maps the results that can be a useful tool for policymakers and decision makers in order to understand better the results of this type of the analysis and identify the the effects of the characteristics of the building vary in the space. I want to spend more some word about the variation of the visualization of the results for the two models about the accessibility characteristics. In the this slide, it's possible to say that the multi-scale model are able to represent the difference in the space from the distance of the metro line better than the traditional geographical weighted derogation. In this slide, it's possible to see which are the area that are most affected by the distance of the from the MRT. That is located in particular in the north and the west of the city, where the network of the metro line is not widely developed. To conclude, it's possible to say that the two local regression model works in order to identify the urban dynamics of the characteristics of the housing. But the multi-scale geographical weighted regression calibration works better because are able to calculate different bandwidths for the different characteristics and to identify the local spatial distribution of this variation. Like future perspective, we want to use the walking distance in order to calculate the accessibility variable, because it could be a better indicator for measure the accessibility to this infrastructure, and new other urban infrastructure could be investigated in order to obtain an overview of all urban sectors. And last but not least, we would like to verify how the trend of consumer preferences vary over the time, comparing different data sets that collect observation in of dwellings sold in different times. So I have concluded my presentation.
Thank you, Federico. I ask the public if someone have a question for Federico for the presentation. Okay, so.
Sorry, I have just a curiosity.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, Federico. Thank you for your interesting presentation. I have just a curiosity of your work. So how did you consider the age of the building? So did you have a database or you have to building the dataset with the various age?
Okay, thank you for your question. We were very lucky because the database that we used is a very complete database that includes more information, and among the information that are present, there is the age of construction. So to calculate the age of building, we have calculated the difference between the age of the construction, the year of the construction of the building, and the year of the sales. So in this way, we have calculated the age and considered the time in the model. Because we have to face the problem that including the time variable, the year variable, that in a dummy way, it doesn't work. So we have to try a solution to consider also the time, that is a very important variable in the context of the real estate market, in order to limit the autocorrelation in the time space. So we have used this variable in order to consider also this bias that of the hedonic regression model.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Federico. Thank you. So we are perfectly in time. Probably we have some minutes also to take a coffee, and we invite you for the last, then the third part of this session that start at 11:30. So now we are free from our side, and then we have a joint session with the Smart Tourism group. So we will see in 20 minutes. Okay, if you want to join. And thank you all the authors that are now are not here, but thank you for be part of this session, for the very interesting contribution. And then we will see next time with Federico and me as chair, and Professor Borruso for the Smart Tourism session. So thank you.
Streaming is on.
Buongiorno.
Buongiorno.
Ciao Marika. Ciao Giulia. Ciao Tiziana. Ciao. Giulia Crespi voleva provare la condivisione dello schermo.
Good morning.
Good morning, I'm Lucia. I'm the assistant for this room.
Good morning.
Sorry, we have to speak English because we are online on YouTube.
Ah, okay, sorry.
Okay, I'm just trying to share the screen.
Yes, yes, John.
Okay. So, is it okay? Do you see the presentation?
Perfect.
Yes.
Okay, perfect, thank you. I should come here. Okay, thanks.
Marika, have you tried?
Yes, thank you. I'm going to share. Okay, can you see the presentation?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, full screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, for the all participants, if you want to insert your name, you can click on the three dots near the red phone, and on the first line, you can insert your name.
Tanto li chiamiamo.
No, se no. Thank you. Ciao Marika, ciao Giulia.
Buongiorno, ciao.
Ciao.
Ciao, ciao. We have 5 minutes more, so and then we start, okay, with Marika.
Okay.
So I think we can, that we can start. Hello and welcome to the first session of Building Multidimensional Model for Assessing Project Complex Environmental System and the first part of the Smart Tourism session. For each subsession, there are two interventions for a total of four presentations. The first presentation is entitled Supporting the Transition from Linear to Circular Economy for the Sustainability Protocols, and will be presented by Marika Gaballo. Marika, please share your screen. The stage is yours. Minutes for the presentation.
Okay, thank you so much. I'll share my screen. Okay, can you see the screen?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, perfect, thank you. So good morning to everybody. I'm Marika Gaballo, a PhD student at this department of Politecnico di Torino, and the research I'm going to present considers on the paradigm shift that cities are experiencing toward more circular urban system, considering the recent exploration of the Ellen MacArthur Foundation for the application of circular economy principles within cities and promoting in particular sustainability protocols as a useful tool to spread the design of a sustainable built environment. With this in mind, this research identifies two of the most widely used neighborhood scale sustainability protocol at the international level, the LEED, the neighborhood development, and the BREEAM communities, aiming to understand how they can be effective tools in supporting the transition. So the sustainability protocol as assessment tools aim to ensure a low environmental impact of the construction sector through the application of a rating system. And in terms of application, these tools range from the scale of the single building to the broader scale of the neighborhood and more recent also the cities. So as the Ellen MacArthur Foundation points out, the neighborhood scale offer ideal condition for the proximity of share and frequently used resource, material, and products. And this is why this scale was chosen in this research. So the methodology used develops from an initial investigation of the principle and key elements highlighted by the Ellen MacArthur Foundation for Circular Cities, and then considering the two protocols identified, a comparative analysis is provided in order to highlight whatever the principle and the key element of the circular economy are effectively considered in their assessment framework, considering in particular two consecutive steps. So first, framing the LEED and the BREEAM protocols in terms of categories considered, and second, analyzing the criteria of each category, stating how many criteria can be traced back to the principle and the key element of the circular economy within cities. Within its initial exploration, the Ellen MacArthur Foundation outlines three principles to be pursued, on which five elements are based. So regarding the three principles, this relates to the waste and pollution, considering the negative externalities, the products, components, and material, referring to keep components and material circulating and contributing to the economy, and then natural system, considering the enhancement of the natural capital. These three principles are applied considering five key elements, which include a built environment widely used with flexible and modular spaces, an efficient and renewable energy systems to reduce cost and also having a positive impact on the urban environment, a multimodal urban mobility system, and a urban economy to generate value and minimize waste, and production systems that encourage local economic circuits also through digital application. So in order to provide the basis for the comparative analysis, both the sustainability protocol were analyzed, highlighting their structure and categories considered in terms of the content analyzed. It has to be underlined that both protocols within the assessment frameworks consider five categories divided into prerequisite that the project must have in order to proceed with the assessment, criteria which deepen each categories, and credits assigned to the criteria to differentiate their importance within the assessment. So in spite of this similarity, the LEADS reports 44 total criteria compared to the 14 for BREEAM, and the maximum credit score achievable is 110 in LEAD compared to 123 in BREEAM, deriving from 119 credits from the mandatory assessment plus four optional credits, considering the sixth optional category related to the particular innovative project. And finally, the BREEAM assigned credits also to the prerequisites. Looking in detail at the categories considered, starting from the LEAD, the neighboring pattern and design provide the highest weight, immediately followed by the categories green infrastructure and building, and site location and linkages. In fact, the choice of the intervention and the design choices adopted are both considered fundamental from a sustainable point of view. Regarding the BREEAM instead, the category social and economic well-being has the highest weight, underlying a significant difference from the other four categories. This highlights the predominance of the social economic elements. And moreover, this protocol recognizes that the site selection and management are almost as important as sustainable mobility policies. And moreover, the governance issues are less significant in defining the degree of sustainability of a neighborhood. So in order to understand if the principle and key element of circular economy are captured, the criteria of both protocols were so analyzed in depth. Starting with each category, an analysis of the description of each criterion was conducted, listing how many criteria for each category considered within the protocol meet the principle and the key element of the circular economy. And in particular, in the LEADS categories are 35 out of 44. So the majority of criteria are contained within the green infrastructure and building category, which is the second highest weighted categories within the protocol, as seen before. And moreover, the neighborhood pattern and design, which is the first most weighted category within the protocol, contain 9 out of 35 criteria, equally also to the site, location and linkages. It is interesting to note that innovation and regional priority, which have less weight, do not contain any criteria meeting the circular economy. So from this first analysis can be underlined that despite the effort made to include aspects related also to the social issues and mobility, the LEAD still provide a focus on energy environmental aspect. Regarding the BREEAM, this contains a total of 32 criteria out of 14, that means the circular economy, against the 35 out of 44 of the previous LEAD. So let's say that these two protocols are somehow balanced. Within the BREEAM, the social and economic well-being, which has the highest weight, also contain, as you can see, the highest number of criteria, while the other categories contain 6 out of the 32 criteria, with the exception of the governance category, which contain no one. So in this case, as opposed to the LEAD, there is a willingness to move beyond the energy environmental aspect, including also the social one. So after analyzing the criteria in terms of content, a comparative analysis was also conducted to highlight the importance of the criteria. Therefore, for each criterion was highlighted how many credits were assigned, and to understand its importance, the credits assigned to each criterion were compared to the overall credit considered in the protocol. So finally, the values obtained were normalized to bring them into percentage terms. In the LEAD, the principle considered with the most weight is natural system, which also contained also the most criteria seen before. Furthermore, the key elements urban mobility system, which also contain the highest number of criteria, differ significantly from the others, carrying the highest weight of 15.9%. And this may be due to the fact that the LEAD pays attention to the promotion of a multimodal system incorporating public transport with other forms of sustainable mobility. And this is particularly in line with the circular economy key elements or mobility that promotes an accessible and efficient mobility system. Finally, it is interesting to note that the productive system accounts for only 2%. Although the BRIM show an effort to include the social economic aspect, the principal natural system, also in this case, is the one related to the most criteria, having the either ways. So the key elements, urban mobility system and built environment, instead at the higher waste, presenting a very low percentage difference. And while the key element, urban bioeconomy, show a weight of 0% that is in line with the fact that it has no criteria within the protocol, as seen before. So to summarize, the protocols show a similar propensity to evaluate the regeneration of natural system. However, the principle of product, component and material, and waste and pollution can be seen somehow as consequential to natural system, considering that they also contribute to the regeneration, so not being less important, but therefore instrumental. And moreover, from the perspective of translating the circular economy principles into key elements, urban mobility and built environment seem to be fundamental to both protocols. In fact, these are widely studied phenomena, and therefore their measurement is more reliable and report a greater ability to intervene on these two elements from a sustainability perspective. And finally, it is interesting to know that the key element energy system within BRIM has a higher weighting than LEED, despite having only one criteria, which nevertheless has a significantly higher weighting than the four of LEED. So this research made it possible to highlight whether the sustainability protocol are evolving considering the circular economy paradigm shift within cities. And it can be noted that the neighborhood scale sustainability protocols considered already give a significant contribution toward the transition. In fact, the principle and the key elements are strongly represented within the protocol, considering also issues that pursue, let's say, a long-term sustainability. For example, giving more importance to aspects such as the reduction of the externality caused by mobility or the value of material and components used. So in spite of progress, issues related to the production system that improve the local and the urban bioeconomy are already considered, considered. And so despite their broader vision of the neighborhood, the focus is still on design-related issues. So in order to conclude, this research laid the foundation for further developments, including a more in-depth analysis to understand in which terms sustainability protocol can really help to implement the circular economy paradigm, with the aim of analyzing the criteria and indicator used within the assessment framework in order to understand its content and function. And therefore, the measurability will be the subject of future development linked also within the ongoing departmental research of the Politecnico di Torino called KISH, of which the first author of this paper, the Professor Lamy, is the referent, which briefly is driven by the awareness that following the pandemic, an innovation is necessary in the indicator framework of the Sustainable Development 11 on cities of the 2013 agenda. So with this in mind, several existing approaches for constructing indicators to measure urban sustainability at different scale will be explored, including measurement techniques used through the sustainability
project. Achieve some specific objective
streaming is on.
Within the concept of circular economy in the cities.
Okay, thank you for the question. Okay, just to be very briefly, let's say that the Ellen MacArthur Foundation has defined five, let's say, universal circular economy policy objective applicable also to the local context, which consider different areas of application, including the urban context. So in order to facilitate city administration in putting into practice, let's say, the transition, the Ellen MacArthur Foundation, in coherence with the goals, the five goals, has identified also 10 policy levers. Among these levers, the sustainability protocols are identified as a potential economic incentive lever to design and, let's say, evaluate the sustainability of the built environment. So, in fact, the implementation of the fiscal measure to favor the diffusion of this tool can also be effective in encouraging positive behaviors toward the process of use of resources within the urban planning policies. So in this sense, this tool could play a potential role in creation of new values toward livable and circular city, contributing to the achievement of the objective of the circular economy.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Marta, for the question and Marika for the interesting presentation. Now we can move to the second contribution entitled Evaluating the Health-Related Social Costs Associated with the Thermal Uses of Residential Sector, the Case of Turin. The authors are Giulia Crespi, Federico Dell'Anna, Tiziana Binda, Cristina Becchio and Marta Bottero from Politecnico di Torino. And I think that Giulia Crespi will present.
Yes.
Okay. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Caterina. Today I will present this presentation together with my colleague, Tiziana Binda. So, good morning to all. I'm a PhD student from the Energy Department of Politecnico di Torino, and I will present our research that we developed in order to estimate the health-related social costs associated to the PM emission caused by the thermal uses in the residential building sector, analyzing a case study application for the city of Turin. The motivation behind our research starts with the consideration that outdoor air quality is gaining interest, especially considering the impacts that air pollutants have on people's health. And this is well represented by the graph showing the deaths caused in 2017 by outdoor air pollution and indoor air pollution. The problem of outdoor air pollution is crucial for the urban areas since there is higher concentration of what are defined as the anthropogenic causes that cause the emission of air pollutants. And in particular, the heating system, which is the core of our presentation, represented almost 30% of the total PM emissions in 2018 in Europe. And these considerations are particularly relevant if we consider also the future trend of urbanization, according to which in 2050, almost 70% of the global population will live in cities. Therefore, due to the weight of air pollution, in particular outdoor air pollution, on health effects for people, its accounting for in urban and economic planning is fundamental. And for this reason, there is the need to provide suitable methodological approaches and science-based tools in order to estimate the risks associated to outdoor air pollution. And in this regard, our work aims to investigate the relationship between these elements, so the air pollutants and the people, with the building sector, aiming to quantify the health impacts caused by the PM10 emissions associated with the thermal uses of residential buildings, and in exploring the capability of different retrofit interventions for buildings to reduce the health-related social costs. In particular, to accomplish this objective, the work proposes a multi-step methodological framework aiming to couple the typical energy and environmental assessment of the emissions caused by the building sector with the socioeconomic evaluation aiming to quantify and estimate the health-related social costs associated with those emissions. In particular, the first step of the methodology consists in the energy and environmental assessment of the current state of the building stock using the reference building approach. The term reference building is used to indicate a typical building, which energy performance and characteristics can be considered as representative of a portion of the building stock. And in particular, according to this definition, knowing the specific energy consumption of each reference building considered and knowing the stock floor area represented by each reference building, it is possible to estimate the total energy consumption and thus the total pollutant emissions caused by the modeled building stock. Then the step of the socioeconomic evaluation was developed using the cost of illness method, which approach aims to evaluate the total economic burden that an illness imposes on the entire society and estimating the total costs as the sum of direct, indirect, and intangible costs. In particular, the former represents all the healthcare and non-healthcare costs due to treatment and care, which are usually based on market values from national statistics. Indirect costs are instead those associated to productivity losses. So due to the absence of the workers from the place of work due to the occurrence of the disease. And finally, intangible costs are those associated to more subjective factors such as quality of life or pain and suffering. The former voices of cost were estimated using the human capital approach, while the last using the willingness to pay method. Then, in order to couple the energy environmental assessment and the socioeconomic evaluation, a multi-domain KPI was defined, named Social Cost Index, which is calculated as the ratio between the total health-related social costs and the total emissions generated by the building stock under investigation, in order to estimate the costs associated to each unit of PM10 emitted by the building stock. Finally, the fourth step of the methodology consists in the definition and assessment of different retrofit scenarios, and in particular, each retrofit intervention is associated to the recalculation of total energy consumptions and total pollutant emission, and then assuming to keep fixed the social cost index, and so the ratio between costs and emissions, it is possible to associate to each retrofit intervention also the variation of the social costs. The methodological framework was applied for the case study of the city of Turin, located in the northwest of Italy, and focusing on only on residential buildings and focusing on the assessment of the thermal uses, so space heating and domestic water, since they represent the most relevant voice of energy consumption and emissions, since they still make use mainly of fossil fuels. In particular, the first analysis was developed using the reference buildings that were defined within the European project Tabula, which identified 32 reference buildings for the city of Turin, divided between different building typologies and the periods of construction. And according to the methodology described, per each reference building, space heating and domestic hot water consumptions were estimated. And then, knowing the stock floor area represented by each reference building, it was possible to estimate the total PM emissions generated by the residential stock and equal to 12 tons per year.
So, for the socioeconomic evaluation, it was used the cost of fitness, and in particular the human capital approach, to estimate the tangible cost, which is composed by the direct cost, the sum of the hospitalization and medication cost, and the indirect cost that we go to estimate the work of loss index. Instead, to estimate the intangible cost, we're used the method of willingness to pay, where usually by submitting surveyed to the concerned population. In that case, it was estimated the years of lost life. Unfortunately, due to the time constraint, the balance is coming from the literature work. The sum of the tangible cost, which is almost 500 euro, and the intangible cost, which is equal to 700 euro, give us the total of cost of fitness, which is around 1,000 euro per person per year. The following step, it was to define the multiple demand X set, which is allowed to estimate that a ton of PM10 emission can cover the social cost, which is in that case 100 euro per person. The next step, it was to try to define the best and the best scenario in order to reduce the environment impact. The retrofit is only on the system. This is because we wanted to evaluate if there is some benefit. It was created two types of scenario. In the first, we go to basically use three technological options, condensing gas boiler, biomass boiler, and electric heat pump. Instead, in the second scenario, it was used just two technology options without the use of biomass boiler. For both of the scenario, four renovation rates are used, ranging to 25% to 100%. Also, the intervention is applied only on the 75% of the referencing building, so the building that are built between 1946 and the 2005. The results are quite interesting, especially the first scenario, where we have a negative effect, that is mean that is an increase of the PM10 emission instead of reduction. This is because there is the presence of the biomass source, and the consequence of this, it creates a negative effect as well from the economic point of view, where for 100% of renovation rate, there is an economic loss, which is around 13,000 €1,000 per person for years. Instead, in the second scenario, when we go to remove the biomassers, we start to see the decrease of the emission of the pollutant. And in particular, for the higher level of the renovation rate, there is a decrease of the PM10, which is equal to the 30%. This gives as well a positive economic benefit that for the high renovation rate, we have a social benefit around €350 per person for years. So in conclusion, from the analysis of these studies emerge how the well-being and the satisfaction should be included in the urban energy planning, and also that the presence of the biomass can give a negative effect for the local environment. The innovation of this work is the multidisciplinary analysis, which allowed to investigate the relationship between the energy and the social economic aspect. In fact, for the future perspective, we thought it would be interesting from the energy side to try to find a different scenario where we go to use a new technology and different and a new technology, the integration of renewable energy sources, and to go to as well to intervene on the envelope. From the social economic side, for the future work, it will be interesting to estimate the local willingness to pay by to submit the survey to the Turing citizen. Thanks so much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Giulia, and thank you, Tiziana, for the interesting presentation. I ask, as usual, if there are some questions from the public, from Cagliari. I don't think so. Okay, I have a curiosity. I see that you have considered as a emission component only the PM10 emission. So why you have decided to use only this one, and why this one for your analysis? Thank you.
Yes, thank you for the question. Actually, the choice is double. First of all, in environmental terms, it is actually clear that PM10 emissions, PM10 pollutant is actually one of the most dangerous for the health of people. And it is also expressed by the interest that is being dedicated to this kind of outdoor air pollutant in the last years, especially in the urban environments and especially in a city as Turin, for which the environmental impact due to these outdoor air pollutants in particular is significant. The other reason behind the selection of this PM10 pollutant is that due to its danger, actually, it is the most present in literature works. So it was the pollutant for which it was simpler to find data and quantitative data also for the socioeconomic evaluation. And so for this reason, this pollutant was selected for the analysis. Actually, it would be interesting in future work, maybe to explore also or to use the same methodological approach also for other pollutants, concentrating on outdoor pollutants, and if it would be possible to find the data and more data about them.
Thank you also for the clear answer. Thank you very much, Giulia. Okay, so I think that our session is finished, and there is, so I would like with Federico to thank all the authors for the very interesting contribution and to be perfectly in time. So thank you very much. And then probably we can go on with the...
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, now let's move on the presentation of the two contributions planned for the smart tourism session. The first presentation is entitled Ancient Mining Path and Slow Tourism, Assessment and Challenges in Sardinia, Italy. and was proposed by Ginevra Balletto, Giuseppe Barruso, Alessandra Milesi, Mara Ladu e Luigi Mundula. Alessandra Milesi is the presenter.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much. This contribution is the result of the joint work about, by the authors Ginevra Balletto, Giuseppe Barruso, Mara Ladu and Luigi Mundula. The title, as I say, is Ancient Mining Path and Slow Tourism, Assessment and Challenges in Sardinia. Slow tourism is a sustainable way of traveling, not based on the consumption of resources and linked to the discovery of places and traditions, which promote a responsible development of the territory. It better responds to the new needs due to change in lifestyles and the way of traveling caused by the restriction imposed by the COVID-19 pandemic. In the last years, Pazel became one of the most successful and appreciated destinations of slow tourism, and particularly in Italy, it became one of the main symbols of slow tourism. In 2017, the MIBACT established the digital atlas of the paths of Italy that included also ancient mining path of Santa Barbara in the southwest of Sardinia. In this background, the contribution investigates the role of slow tourism, in particular of the walks, in defining the policies of the tourism development over the Sardinia regions, and takes the territory of Sulcis Iglesiente in the southwest of Sardinia as a research area where the recent establishment of the Santa Barbara Path in a sensitive area marked by intense mining activity offers the opportunity to set up an initial assessment of the role of a path in the tourist development of this region. In particular, the author analyzed the principles and the potential replicable elements of this first experience, defining a methodology to compare, by specific index proposal, the new concept of Santa Barbara paths with the first paths realized in Sardinia. In particular, the conception of the mining landscape and heritage as element to be valued originated with the establishment of a Geomining Historic Environmental Park of Sardinia in 2001 as a tool to protect and safeguard all the tangible and intangible heritage. It is divided 8 areas covering 81 municipalities. The Santa Barbara Path represents one of the project carried out in the park. And it is a circular route that retraces the ancient mining of the Sulcis Iglesiente Cuspinese in this area, in a landscape characterized by a complex geological heritage and industrial archaeology, and by a significant number of points of historical, cultural, and naturalistic interest, reception and reflection activities along this route. After this positive experience, the Pozzo Salonis Association verified the existence of favorable conditions for the construction of other new works in other contexts of the island. In particular, they individed other three areas, one in the northwest, one in the midwest, and one in the southwest of Sardinia. The proposed methodology aims to compare this recently proposed of Santa Barbara routes, here called 2, 3, and 4 SBP, with the first Santa Barbara route, which represents a best practice in terms of export and replication of the model mining route. In particular, the authors developed a specific replication method based on a composite index referring to the inclusion of community and the environment, called the ICE index. In particular, the methodology makes it possible to evaluate how the recent proposal of the new three routes are in line with the guidelines for the development of the territorial tourist product Santa Barbara Mine Train, with a particular reference to the following factors: prevention, promotion, participation, and partnership. In this sense, the main factor of inclusion, such as belonging to the Giovanni Park, constitute the first indicators of which, on which the ICE index is based. The ICE index can be represented as follows, and it is composed by the incident factor of community environment inclusion factors, divided into prevention, promotion, participation, and partnership, the weight, and the number of incident factors. The ICE index then must be divided by maximum ICE index in order to obtain an ICE index relating to the group for which the comparison is to be made. At first, the authors compare the four paths referring to their intrinsic characteristic as length, number of stage, average length of stage, and altitude and accessibility. Furthermore, since the four paths analyzed fall within the geomineral park, it was considered appropriate to evaluate for each one the incidence in terms of territorial area concerned and the number of municipalities crossed with the same park, the population, the number of municipalities involved, and the percentage incidence of regional and rural routes. The author proceeded to extrapolate the input data we can see in this scheme, and the output data that is the ICE index, referring to the best practice, that is the number one SBP. The evaluation of the ICE index allows us to highlight how the three proposals still differ considerably from the reference case, in particular the number three path, because the few municipalities, the small size of the communities involved, that determine an index like about half lower than that of the reference. In fact, it is, we can see the difference. In conclusion, the exportability of the best practice at the moment does not occur in absolute terms, in particular because the proposed routes insist in marginal proportion compared to the sub-areas of the geomineral park, and the limited number of municipalities involved does not facilitate network actions. In fact, at the base of the success of the paths, the ability to network between institutions and the communities plays a strategic role, able to promote a transition from anti-commons, demanding activities, to commons, museum, cultural tourism activities, to semi-commons, the temporary cultural and the tourist use. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for the presentation. As for the others, I ask if there are some questions for the public or from online. No one from Cagliari.
If I can, I have a curiosity.
Thank you, Federico.
Okay. First of all, thank you for submitting the contribution and for presenting this multidisciplinary and interesting approach. I have a curiosity about the construction of this aggregate index, and I want to know if you have considered different weights for the different index we used for the calculation of this aggregate index, and if so, how did you done it?
I don't understand. I hear really bad. Can you repeat?
Okay, sorry. Have you proposed this aggregated index, so composed by other key indicators? I have understood. So have you considered to consider the these indicators have the same importance for the calculation of the aggregated index, or they have the same importance?
No, this indicator is not the same important, and the way it is useful to guarantee this different weight of these indicators. In fact, as I say, in particular, the number of population and of the number of inhabitants involved and then the number of municipalities as very important for the for the creation of a network between municipality and communities and by the success of the parts.
Okay. Understood. Thank you for your answer.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so we can move to the last contribution of this first part of Smart Tourism session, entitled Sustainability, Tourism and Digitalization, the City Smart Approach in Las Palmas de Gran Canaria, Canary Islands. The contribution is presented by Ainhoa Amaro Garcia, and Silvia Battino.
Yes, Battino. Okay.
The floor is yours.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Good morning to all. So I'm Silvia Battino, researcher at the University of Sassari, and I'm here to represent also the work of Ainhoa Amaro Garcia from the University of Las Palmas de Gran Canaria. So to make it easier to understand, we divide the presentation to four sections. A quick introduction on the smart approach and the meaning of the smart city, and then we highlight the case study of Las Palmas de Gran Canaria. In this context, the purpose of the work was to analyze some tools and strategies adopted this year by the LAG government to improve the use of urban spaces, in particular the tourist ones. Finally, the last part is dedicated to some conclusions. So while concerning the smartness approach, we can create cozy spaces when the concept, when the smart concept is applied to different spaces to make them more accessible and integrated, and where the role of information and communication technologies is essential to activate different sustainable development and growth projects. Today, we apply, you know, the smart concept to cities, to territories in general, and also to tourist destinations. But it's not only the presence of technology in the environment that make it smart. We must also be able to make it available to user to meet their needs and generate new value. And this is what different urban contexts are trying to do, not only when they pursue to the objective of transforming the urban system into a smart space. In this space, they try to improve transport and accessibility, improve social services, and promote sustainability, and also give voice to the citizens. With reference to the case studies, we are talking about the island of Gran Canaria, one of the seven islands of the Canarian archipelago. The island is divided into 21 municipalities, and among these emerge Las Palmas de Gran Canaria. We are in the northeast of the island. Las Palmas is the capital and is the most populated municipality with about 380,000 inhabitants. In addition to being the most populous cities of the archipelago, also occupies the ninth place in the Spanish ranking with a population density of 3,755 inhabitants per square kilometers. In addition to residents, a consistent number of people attend the city daily for business or leisure. For example, in 2019,
They stayed overnight about 450,000 tourists, to which we can add a regular flow, about 720,000 cruise passengers attracted by the many local resources, including the beach of Las Canteras, for example, the historic district of Vegeta, and the park of Santa Catalina. So, for a better use of urban spaces, the local government has been working for a long time to become a smart tourist destination and has already activated over the 3-year period, 2012 and 2014, a strategic plan for new technologies and telecommunications, thanks to which about 44-45 projects have been realized. They also participated along with 5 other cities in the Civita Destinations project, is an European initiative on sustainable mobility. Through a specific line of action, the local government is moving in the promotion of the new technology in 5 specific areas, such as mobility, urban services, public administration, government, tourism, and teleworking. For example, about the mobility area, we can mention the smartphone application LPA Park that facilitated parking and payment without using cash or getting to the nearest parking meter. Another example is LPA Accessible, which makes it possible to locate accessible places in buildings, streets, and other places in the city, and automatically sends a notification to family members or local police when accident, for example, occur. And this information gives the city access to several data points, and that can be further explored to improve the accessibility of urban spaces. In relation to urban services, the PA Avisa is a service information tool on the city's facilities. It has been active since February in 2013 and lets the citizen to report incident and also breakdowns. For example, it makes possible to shoot and reference the location of the incident and eventually report it to a local municipality staff member. Then we can post comments, view alert history, and review the resolution of the problem at a later time. So the innovative technology are also used to deliver several services of the public administration. This has made it possible, particularly in this critical period, to speed up or eliminate waiting times for citizens. In this slide, we have noted some of tools that have been improved for the fruition of the cultural offer, for example, to obtain documents and to monitor the attendance to some areas. About this last application, we want to remember the one dedicated to the access to the 3 beaches of the city. The screenshot of the application, the slide, shows how it's possible to check the turnout at the beach through a virtual traffic light. In green, we see the portion on the beach where the turnout is still low, and with yellow, the portion of the beach with medium crowding. In the future, the application will be implemented to make it possible to predict the location of resources of the beach in relation to such events, temperature, arrival of cruise ships, and other activities. This action will be applied mainly in the beach of Las Canteras, where the technological architecture, for example, the sensor, able to record different data will be realized. So finally, the most recent development with which the local government is trying to mitigate the economic consequences of the pandemic. An advertising campaign has been launched to attract home workers to stay on the island. The attraction plan includes the programming of several events and initiatives that can act as additional attractor for these new tourists.
So in conclusion, today, the creation of an integrated system to enhance urban space implies investing time and money in new technologies. Especially this period of health emergency, it's important to activate strategies that can stimulate and help the smart development of spaces to improve the quality of life of residents and tourists. So Las Palmas de Gran Canaria had already begun to work in this direction and with greater intensity has activated smart initiatives to make sure that the city space can be enjoyed safely. In this context, the presence of the public administration has been a fundamental help, playing a central role in the search for more efficient and effective solutions and processes. To overcome this crisis, Las Palmas has set out a roadmap, activating, for example, initiatives capable of serving, analyzing, and reporting real-time the dynamics of searches, reservation on the internet, or, for example, offering citizens and tourists information on the physical safety distance from public spaces and the possibility of combining work with pleasure. We can say basically that we are looking at new digital tools that allow the destination to remain competitive and attract the new segment of tourists. So that's it. In this first step of the research, we studied the state of the art related to the local tool and strategies. And for the second step of the work, we hope to be able to process some of this data. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
for the presentation. I like very much because I did my Erasmus in Las Palmas de Gran Canaria, so I love this presentation also for many places that I lived for many months. So thank you also for this part. Okay, so I ask from the public if there are some questions.
I
have a question. Yes, thank you, Marco. But in general, it's a very interesting work because also in our department, we are starting analyzing scenarios for smart, in particular at district scale, about application and scenario for a sustainable development or city related to transport and mobility processes. Yes. So it's very interesting because it gives us some interesting perspective for our work. We work in a more in our urban planning perspective, but all these applications and how to meet the citizens' needs with the urban planning is very useful. Yes. So thank you very much.
Okay. Mine is more a curiosity than a question. Yes. Because I have somehow studied this theme of destination tourism management, and I know that somehow also studying some already realized experiences. There is this destination management is built on a brand that rests on local local products, local specificity or something else. Mm-hmm. I wanted to know if in Las Palmas de Canaria there is something similar already implemented, or also if it is which can be if there is a role of information technologies in the promotion of this local brand, we can say. Or if it is in your plan to develop something similar?
No, for this step, we represent the state of the art without this part that about your question. And the second step is we hope to collaborate with municipality department to extrapolate to elaborate the data in particular related to the perception of citizens.
Okay, with the aim to build strategies or not?
Yes, with in particular the work of the resident that is my colleague,
I know Amaro Garcia that have more collaboration with the department. And in the second, in not the second, other in the future, we hope to improve this work.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Thank you for your question.
Okay, thank you very much. And I think that we can conclude perfectly in time. And again, I would thank you, the author, for the interesting presentation. From our side, it's not our session, but I think it's useful also for us to see different perspectives that in some way are in line with other research that we try to apply, also in which we try to apply scenario building tools in order to support municipality to choose the best strategies based on the characteristic of the place where we are, and in general the objective of the municipality in order to improve their city. So thank you very much. Okay. Thank you, Federico.
Okay, thank you. See you later. Bye-bye.